Father, we come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus, asking that you would teach us, that we would understand the things that we have before us, and we would also learn the warnings that are here. So we entrust our time to you in Christ's name. Amen. So a couple of weeks ago, we got to David and his bringing the ark into Jerusalem, setting up a kind of double dividing the tabernacle. If you recall, the Ark of the Covenant's brought back to Jerusalem. He sets up a tent in Jerusalem, which he's made his capital. But the rest of the tabernacle is on Gibeon, which is a few miles north of Jerusalem. And it had been 100 years that the Ark had been in any way central to Israel's life. So that's all a significant improvement, but it still isn't the way God intends it to be. So David announced his desire to build a house for the Lord, told it to Nathan. Nathan said to him, go for it. And then the Lord wakes up Nathan in the middle of the night and says, no, that's not the way it's going to happen. He's not going to build a house for me. I'll build a house for him, and gives him the promise of the house of David in terms of the royal family, the royal house. And that's still language we use. The family of Queen Elizabeth is the House of Windsor, so that all carries on, that kind of language. But he also says his son, who will come after him, will build a house for my name. So now we're to Solomon. And the story of Solomon, I was trying to think of what we'll do with this. We're going to take 2 weeks walking through it. Tonight, I want to think mainly about the construction of the temple, the structure of the temple, and all of the details related to that. It is found in two passages. It's found in 1 Kings, and in, we're going to look at, not all of it, chapter 3, 5, 6, and 7 tonight. It's also found in 2 Chronicles, chapters 3 and 4, this same account. So if you take your Bibles and turn with me, first of all, to the preparation stage for this. And there's a comment in chapter 3 that I just want to notice. The first two chapters of 1 Kings are really about Solomon coming to the throne, David stopping the attempt to make someone else king, and then Solomon's being coronated and Solomon's reign being established. And so when we get to chapter 3, he is established as the king. Last verse of chapter 2, the kingdom was established in the hand of Solomon. Solomon made a marriage alliance with Pharaoh, king of Egypt. He took Pharaoh's daughter and brought her into the city of David until he'd finished building his own house and into the house of Yahweh and the wall around Jerusalem. So that tells us two things. First of all, on one level, that was a very prestigious secular alliance. To marry the daughter of the Pharaoh was to be, in effect, in a kind of alliance with him. It wasn't a love match, it was a political match. That's how these things happened in the ancient world. But it has all kinds of, at least I guess we could say, yellow flashing things over it, if not red flashing signals related to it. And the other thing that's indicated is that he's already very quickly begun this building project. He brought her into the city of David. Later tonight, we'll get a sense of what that's about. Until he'd finished building his own house, the house of the Lord, and the wall around Jerusalem. Well, in point of fact, that's going to be a 20-year project. So he's not where this fits. But verse 2, the people were sacrificing at the high places. Now, Gibeon is called a high place, but Gibeon was where the tabernacle was. And so that was in some sense legitimate, but the other ones aren't. And so there's a number of them. And it says, no house had yet been built for the name of the Lord. We'll come back to that phrase, the name of the Lord, the house for the name of the Lord, in a minute. It's verse 3 that I want to draw your attention to, because it sounds so good and it sounds so positive but it's Solomon in a nutshell. Solomon loved Yahweh, walking in the statutes of David, his father. And if the sentence ended there, you'd think, isn't that terrific? Finally, we've got a king who's passing it on, and his son is picking up and walking that. And that statement is made. It's the only, or except, I think as it is in some translations, except he sacrificed and made offerings at the high places. And it's interesting because that's going to be Solomon, writ large. There's a part of him that loves the Lord and follows in his ways. And there's another part of him that says, but I can do it my way in this particular issue. And it's that except that becomes the great issue for Solomon. And as I think about it in my own life, it's very easy to have that except in my life. He loved the Lord and walked in the ways that he ought to, except. And you think of some area in your life that you just sort of carve out and say, yeah, but you know, I don't have to be that strict on that particular way. So this is going to be Solomon's fatal flaw, and it will erupt in full display a little bit later. So now we're over to chapter 5. Chapter 4 is all about Solomon's wisdom and the extension of his kingdom. And chapter 5 begins with, now Hiram, king of Tyre, sent his servants to Solomon when he heard that they'd anointed him king in place of his father. For Hiram always loved David. So this is a Phoenician pagan king. And Phoenicia at this part is one of the great trading countries in the world. They really controlled the Mediterranean and were famous for their shipping all through that area. So it's a wealthy country in that particular way. And Solomon sent word to Hiram. You know that David, my father, could not build a house for the name of Yahweh, his God, because of the warfare with which his enemies surrounded him, until Yahweh put them under the soles of his feet. But now Yahweh, my God, has given me rest on every side. There is neither adversary or misfortune, so I intend to build a house for the name of Yahweh, my God. As Yahweh said to David, my father, your son, whom I will set on your throne in your place, shall build the house for my name. Now, therefore, command that the cedars of Lebanon be cut for me, and my servants will join your servants. I'll pay you for your servants and wages as you set, for you know there's no one among us who knows how to cut timber like the Sidonians. So there's several things that are involved in that. First of all, there's that phrase that was already used back in chapter 3. It's used here, a house for the name of Yahweh. It almost certainly means something like a house that is worthy of the reputation. A house or a temple that will properly display the nature and character of Yahweh. So it is in some way worthy of him and consistent with him. It isn't a house for the person of Yahweh. Solomon will be very clear. The Lord doesn't dwell in a building, but it's a house. His presence will be there, and his name is attached to it in some particular way. So it is to be worthy of him. It's interesting, though, how he talks about it. The house for the God of his father, or pardon me, a house for his God, for the name of his God, and then it changes it to a house for the name of my God, and then he will say a house for my name, using the Lord's terminology. He's a pagan, and it's interesting that Solomon doesn't give a clear witness to what he's doing. He's not building a house for the God of David. He's building a house for the one true living God. And there's that kind of pulling back from making it clear that this is not just for my God, it is for God himself. Now, the rest of the chapter is about Solomon doing two things, making material preparation for the temple and then providing labor for the temple. So in verses 7 to, verse 13? I'll find it easier to find out if I pick up my glasses. It's the trade deal that he establishes with Hiram. The mountains of Lebanon were famous for cedar trees, and they were renowned around the world. And so cedar is going to be a main part of the building project. When David talked to Nathan about it, he said, it's not right for me to live in a cedar house and God's living in a tent. So that back in the very beginning of the story, it was all about cedar is kind of the luxury dwelling of this particular place. And that wasn't available. What Israel had was agricultural land. What Lebanon had was mountain terrain, and the cedars of Lebanon were world famous. So having grown up in logging country up in British Columbia, you know well about all of those kind of things and these big stately trees, evergreens that can grow and are terrific for building projects to get the beams that he needed for the kind of construction he was going to do. And he makes an arrangement that he will pay and there'll be this exchange. Behind that, there's something troubling. And that is, at the end of the deal, when it's all struck, he will end up giving Hiram 20 villages to pay for his debt. And as you begin to think, this is land that God has given to us, and I'm giving away the land to pay for it. Actually, Hiram had no use for the land. He called it Kabul, worthless, but nevertheless, that principle is there. Now, the second thing that he does is verse 13. King Solomon drafted forced labor out of all Israel, and the draft numbered 30,000 men. And he sent them to Lebanon, 10,000 men a month in shifts. They would be a month in Lebanon, 2 months at home. And then he gives them, he also had 70,000 burden bearers, 80,000 stone cutters, beside 3,300 chief officers. And it goes on to talk about that. So verse 18, so Solomon's builders and Hiram's builders and the men of Gebel did the cutting and prepared the timber and the stone to build the house. Think now, and this will be sort of in the background, how did Moses go about having them build the tabernacle? Whoever is willing, give what you can. And then whoever is skilled and gifted, work on the project. It was a volunteer project. This is now Solomon's project, which is driven by forced labor. And it's going to only grow worse a little bit later. So that, if you recall, when his son comes to the throne, the nation rises up and said, we won't accept Solomon's son unless he agrees that we're not going to be enslaved by forced labor. So one of the ironies of the story is this great house for the building of God becomes indirectly the source, because of Solomon's choices related to it, becomes the source of the division of the country. And so there's sort of a heavy irony in the midst of doing a good thing, and it's ironic to say it, in an unwise way. And this is the wisest man who ever lived on one level, which tends to tell you about human wisdom in a significant way. So that's the preparation stage. Now, you remember David had already laid up a bunch of stuff. And what we don't know anywhere through here, and there's no mention that Solomon ever looked at the plan that David had given to him. He may have. It may be all according to that plan. He may have used all that material. We just don't know about that. So it's when we get to chapter 6 now, we get the building of the temple beginning to be described. So notice chapter 6, verse 1. In the 480th year after the people of Israel came out of the land of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month of Ziv, which is the second month, he began to build the house of Yahweh. Now, I've referred to this on other occasions. This is one of those passages that helps us date things in terms of the Old Testament. Solomon became king, we know from other ways, in 971. So this is the fourth year of his reign. That's 967, 966. Can't be sure sort of how that calendar falls. Now, it says this was 480 years after they came out of Egypt. So if we take that number literally, that means that the date of the Exodus is 1446, 1447 BC. Tracking with me? So when you're thinking about how do we date events in the Old Testament, this is one of the key verses that tells us. Now, there are some who come along and say 480 years isn't really to be taken literally. It is really a statement, a lifetime of a generation was 40 years, and that means 12 generations, because they believe the Exodus was dated in around 1290 rather than 1446, 1447. Nothing in the text immediately suggests that. And while some good and Bible-honoring people believe that, I think we're safer to say with what the numbers are that they're given in the text, and to date this at the Exodus at around 1440, and now we're at 967. And look at the last verse of that chapter. In the fourth year, the foundation of the house of Yahweh was laid, in the month of Ziv. And in the 11th year, in the month of Bul, which is the 8th month, the house was finished in all its parts and according to all its specifications. He was 7 years in building it. So this is a 7-year building project. So somewhere very close to 960, it's finished. So let's go back up to the direction. I'm going to read this. We'll read a certain amount. I'm not going to read it all. We get the description of it. The house that King Solomon built for the Lord was 60 cubits long. So if you think of a cubit as a foot and a half, you can do your own internal math. I'll come back to that in just a minute and do the math. The house that King Solomon built for Yahweh was 60 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, 30 cubits high. The vestibule, the porch in front of the nave of the house, was 20 cubits long, equal to the width of the house, and 10 cubits deep in front of the house. And he made for the house windows with recessed frames. He also built a structure against the wall of the house, running around the walls of the house, both the nave and the inner sanctuary. And he made side chambers all around. The lowest story was 5 cubits broad, the middle one was 6 cubits broad, the third was 7 cubits broad. For around the outside of the house, he made offsets in the walls in order that the supporting beams should not be inserted into the walls of the house. When the house was built, it was with stone prepared at the quarries, so that neither hammer nor axe nor any tool of iron was sold in the house while it was being built. Now, I know that that's confusing at this particular stage. A little bit later, somebody has done a YouTube video that puts this in pictorial form, and it will be a little bit easier. It's not entirely accurate, but it's accurate enough to give you some idea of what's going on. But let's just talk about now the construction. If you look on your outline, I want to talk about the basic structure, and we're going to get into some details, then some innovations that Solomon has put into the building, and then some things about the furnishings and the temple courtyard. Now, somehow I missed. Does somebody have the diagram sheet? I need both of them. Are there? I think there's extra ones still. No, I need.
It's on the back.
It is on this one. Okay, it's not on that one. Sorry. So basically, think about this. You remember the tabernacle. The tabernacle is that central structure. It has the outer courtyard, and then it has the structure. The structure is 15 feet wide, 45 feet long, 15 feet high. Okay, so we have courtyard, the holy place, the initial one, that's 30 feet long, and then the cube in the back, the Holy of Holies, 15 by 15 by 15. Here we've got Solomon, and it's doubled. So the structure is 90 feet long, the box, and 30 feet wide, and 45 feet high. So it's not really just double the size, it's in height larger than double, but we'll come back to that in just a moment. If you look at the diagram that's on the top page, you'll notice basically how it's put together, but it's that inner box that we're talking about, and you can see the porch on the front, we'll come back to that, the Holy of Holies and the holy place. Now, the basic structure, it's made out of limestone, white limestone, which is the most expensive kind, and that's been quarried at off-site so there wasn't a hammer heard on the place. All of it was pre-fitted and done elsewhere and then put together like a Lego set when they got to the particular site. The floor is obviously made out of rock because of the foundation basis, but a cypress wood floor is placed on the, obviously on the bottom, different from the dirt, because there was no floor, if you remember, in the tabernacle. And then the sides of it are paneled in cedar. And the various decorations, pomegranates and other things, are carved into it, and then it is all plated with gold. The floor is gold-plated wood. Side is gold-plated wood. The ceiling is gold-plated wood. It must have been absolutely astonishing to go in and just have this gold overwhelm you in terms of the massiveness of its use. Now, we're not told right here at this part. We are told in verse 20 that the Holy of Holies was 30 feet high. Now, the building's 45 feet high. So, one of two things happened. Either they dropped the ceiling in that part of the building, or almost certainly, they raised the platform. So, there was a 15-foot stairway going up to the Holy of Holies. So, just like in the tabernacle, the Holy of Holies was 15 by 15 by 15, in this case, it's 30 by 30 by 30. So the cube remains. Are you tracking with me? But not in the outer part, which is 45 feet higher. So I think a drop ceiling, first of all, I think that would be in a building like that difficult to do. And it would make sense to heighten that, to give it all that much more prominence and significance along the way. Now, between the Holy of Holies and the holy place, instead of the movable curtain, he builds cedar panels and a cedar door. And that's all covered with gold after things are paved in it. But also, we're told in 2 Chronicles, there was a curtain as well. So you've got the veil, which we're used to in Herod's temple, And then you've got this panel in behind and a doorway to enter into it. Okay, are there questions I can answer? You can look at that drawing that's in front of you to get some sense of what we're talking about inside. So then let's talk about some innovations, because Solomon did some other things. Here's the box. On the outside of the box, on both sides, he builds along the long side a series of storage rooms. And you'll see the construction depicted a little bit better. But there's three levels of them. They're all 7.5 feet tall. And there's a stairway that goes up to the first level and then the second level. And then these are divided. They're of different widths. So the bottom one is 10.5 feet, the next one is 9 feet, and the next one is 7.5 feet. And it's to provide a ledge, and it will be easier to see than for me to try and describe it inwardly on them. Now, what was in those storehouses? Well, obviously supplies for the temple. And some of them may have been used as rooms for other purposes. Later, and we'll see it in a couple of weeks when we get there, this is going to be a major issue of idolatry. And there's going to be idols set up in different ones as different pagan idols are brought into those. But that's his innovation. And then in the entrance porch, he's added, because there was no entrance porch in the tabernacle. So it comes out 15 feet, the entire width of it. And then there's the entrance section of it. And on either side are huge, 27 feet high, pillars, bronze pillars, 6 feet in diameter. I mean, it's fairly impressive if you think that thing's 27 feet high. And these are made by Huram, the Phoenician Israelite half-breed that they have doing the bronze work there to make it all very special. It is so special, and this is kind of weird, that they give it them two names. So one is called Yakin, and the other one is called Boaz. I have no idea, but it keeps saying that Yakin and Boaz, they're strictly ornamental. Now, here's another issue that sort of is undergirding this. That was a feature found in pagan temples. And so we're asking, how much of this is Solomon borrowing from pagan temples and from having pagan workers and doing this with Hiram? We're not sure of that. Well, David gave him plans. We're never told in this passage that Solomon followed those plans. So what I mentioned before. We don't know. There's no mention of David here. But yeah, clearly David in 1 Chronicles 28 says, here are the plans for this. But I don't know. I rather think Solomon thought, Dad did things good, but I'm going to do it on a far grander scale than Dad ever would have done. I can't prove that, but I think this was meant to be a statement about Solomon, not a statement about this was Dad's idea. God's given me permission to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm guessing. Now, one other thing there is so that structure on the side, remember the three levels of storage rooms, above them there are a series of windows, which are really just openings in the stone at that point. There was no external light in the tabernacle. There's external light here. So you can see it on the picture at the bottom. You get some idea of those massive, I said they were 27 feet high, but the capitals on top of them were 7.5 feet high. So you've got 35 feet at that particular stage. You can see the storerooms on the side, on the bottom of that, and the windows along the top. And some of the other design features are entirely an artist's imagination. So the third thing let's talk about are the temple furnishings. Place to begin is in the Holy of Holies. And in the Holy of Holies, what we have is very striking. Up on this ledge, as you walk in, there were two cherubim made of olive wood, covered with gold. A wingspan of 15 feet. So on one side, 7.5, on the other side, 7.5, away from the figure of this angelic being, two of them, so Srenicus, and 15 feet high. And the Ark of the Covenant is placed in between. You remember the Ark of the Covenant is what it is, the atonement cover, the box, the atonement cover, and the cherubim overlooking it. Now, do you remember what size the ark was? 30 inches by 27 inches by 27 inches high. So, picture that. This box, an angel's 15 feet high, 15 or 30 feet wide with their wingspans. And what doesn't look so important anymore? This little ark, which was the place where God's glory resided, the throne of God, and so forth. So you have to think Solomon has shifted the emphasis on this at this particular time, but he won't touch the ark. It is too sacred for him not just to leave as it is. Now, something else that's curious, you might want to look in your Bible at chapter 6, verse 20. And it says, he also overlaid at the end of the verse, he also overlaid an altar of cedar. Verse 22, he overlaid the whole house with gold until all the house was finished, and also the whole altar, the altar of incense, that belonged to the inner sanctuary, he overlaid with gold. Now that's very puzzling, and we don't know. Because in the tabernacle, the incense altar was outside the inner sanctuary, not in it. This seems to say he'd relocated it inside. Hebrews also seems to pick that up. So it isn't entirely clear, but there's an interesting distinction. Then there's the lampstand. How many lampstands are there in the tabernacle? One. How many are there in the temple, would you think? 10. 5 on each side. In the tabernacle, table of the bread of presence. How many? 1. In the temple, 10. So actually, Kings only mentions 1, Chronicles mentions 10. So you get some idea of Solomon's idea about these things. Everything's going to be bigger and better and more impressive. So now we move outside and we get to the temple courtyard. And we have the bronze altar. Well, this is worth reading, so let me Yeah, no, I'm not. That's right, it's not here. It's in Chronicles. I'll read it to you. Here I am looking for it in the wrong book. It's interesting, the altar isn't even mentioned in Kings, but it is mentioned in Chronicles. He made chapter 4 of 2 Chronicles 1. He made an altar of bronze, 20 cubits long, 20 cubits wide, and 10 cubits high. And then it goes on to describe some more things. So now we have an altar, and it's, well, the altar in the tabernacle was 7.5 by 7.5 and 4.5 feet high. This one's four times across, four times that way, so it's immense. But the really puzzling thing is that it's 15 feet high. Now, unless they had some very gifted priests, there was no way they could stand in front and offer the sacrifices. It's 15 feet high. So they must have had some way of getting up there. And in the picture, you'll notice on the outside, it will show you a staircase. Now, the problem with that is in Exodus chapter 20, it was forbidden to have an altar with steps. So almost certainly if they built it in any way, there had to be a ramp going up rather than, you know, to get up to 15 feet high so they can offer the sacrifices. But it takes everything away now. It's being performed up there, not where the people are engaged in being with it, but it's now elevated away from them so they don't see it in the way they would have seen what was going on in the past. And then we move to the bronze basin, chapter 7, verse 23. Well, I've got to go back to Kings. And they call it the sea. Verse 23, he made the sea, the basin, of cast metal. It was round, 10 cubits from brim to brim, 5 cubits high, and a line of 30 cubits measured its circumference. So 15 feet in diameter and 7.5 feet deep on that particular place. The estimate is that it could hold 11,500 gallons of water. But then it isn't just built, it is put on a stand, verse 25. It stood on 12 oxen, three facing north, three facing west, three facing south, and three facing east. These are bronze, obviously, oxen, not living ones. The base and the sea was set on them, and all their rear parts were inward, so they were facing head out into what's going on. So now it's interesting. We've got 7.5 feet, and then what's your guess? If you were making an oxen in this kind of thing, 3 feet, 4 feet? I think 4 feet's probably a good guess. So now you've got it 11.5 feet up in the air. So how did they get there to use it? There's no faucets or anything else. So, and it doesn't say anything about a ramp. Even the diagrams of it, just if you look at the diagram that's there, doesn't tell you anything about how they, or the artist's painting. Well, one of the solutions was he then goes and makes 10 basins on portable stands that were wheeled around, five on one side, five on the other. And they hold about 250 gallons of water each. And those would be the ones that would be most accessible to the priests, and they could be placed in different places as time warranted along the way. So, Richard, let's look at this thing. Now, there's a couple of things that are going to be obvious. This guy is not a brilliant scholar, but he's done a really good job, or a helpful job. There will be steps going up to the altar, and there weren't steps. He will have ladders, but it talks about staircases joining that. And he will have sphinxes, lions, as the cherubim, and they weren't that. And he's going to read the King James Version, because you got the sound to it, and that gets really confusing. So anyway, watch it, though. I think it's useful in giving you some visual picture of this. So you'll notice two things. One is he didn't mention the altar there because he's following Kings, and it's Chronicles that talks about the altar and its size. And it's also Chronicles that tells us there were 10 tables and not just one. And also you'll notice that I was wrong when I said which was the wide one. I said the bottom one was the wide one, and of course it's the top one, the way the thing was built out and laid. But any observations or any questions you have about that? Did that help you at all to sort of get some sense of what's going on? Yes, Mr. Vandiver?
What is the whole molten sea? I just didn't get that thing.
Molten sea?
Well, yeah, the just, molten sea.
It just means it's made out of brass or bronze.
Yeah, but what was its use?
Sea is, I don't know why they called it a sea, except there was a whole lot of water in there. And actually, some of you can imagine how much skill it takes to make a bronze basin like that, that is able to be, I don't know how they would have welded things at that particular stage and how they would have made it so that it was watertight and all of those other things, but that's what it was.
What was its use, though?
It was the same as the basin in the temple. I have no idea. As I said, there's the problem there that there's no way to figure out how they got to the top to get the water that they needed.
They just climbed on the oxen.
Well, even that wouldn't do any good because the base was 7.5 feet. So even an NBA player is not going to be able to get to the top. So
I just have a question. If in Hebrews 3, it says that credits Moses for being faithful in all the details of the house that he was building, and then it compares Jesus. So I'm interested that the Lord let Solomon move around a bit with his ideas instead of doing everything according to the way the pattern on the mount or something. Moses did, but Solomon didn't. Is that true?
We're going to come back to that next week, but one scholar I have been reading, and I'm not convinced by him, but he draws the big distinction how in terms of Moses it was said, as it was shown on the mountain, as it was shown, all of the emphasis on exactness. There's none of that in this one. It says Solomon built it, or Huram, who's a half-breed. His mother was from Naphtali, and his father was a Phoenician. He's responsible for building this. So, but when it says that David was faithful in all his house, it's not talking about the details of the tabernacle, Moses, I mean, the details of the tabernacle, more his serving God in the family and people of God. That was part of it. But Gail?
I noticed that a lot of the symbols kind of reminded me of Egyptian symbols. Is that significant? The choices, like the palm trees and the flowers, does it have a meaning or does it say anywhere? I don't remember.
Pomegranates are one of the main ones that's used. And you also have some of those in the tabernacle as well, so there's some connection there. In the tabernacle, it's very clear. That was ordained by God. In this one, it's not as clear whether those decorations were just artistic design. No human figures, you notice, though. No representation of any humans.
You mentioned that the cherubim don't look like that. What did they look like? We don't know.
Okay. No, we have no idea. You know, we have the descriptions in Ezekiel of that he sees, and you have these unusual figures, but whether that's what the ones in the garden, I mean, this takes us back again to where we began. The cherubim are a symbol of in the garden protecting the presence of God so that Adam and Eve couldn't return to the tree. But beyond that, we have no way of knowing.
The 10 baths. How tall were they again? Could they actually get in them to wash their feet, or did they just?
No, I think they scoop water out of them at that stage.
Okay.
The idea
okay,
wasn't
so
that they would go.
They aren't going to wash their feet. They're going.
Idea wasn't that they were going in to.
Okay.
So. I didn't put in my notes what the size of them was at that stage. I don't remember. Okay, so let's press on for a minute here. And I want to notice two things that are interesting, because the Lord interrupts this twice. So we have the description in chapter 6, and we're going along, and we have all of this material being described, the basic one in verses 1 to 10. So we've got the shell of the building in chapter 1, verse 10. And then in verse 11, now the word of Yahweh came to Solomon, midway in the process, concerning this house that you are building. If you will walk in my statutes and obey my rules and keep all my commandments and walk in them, then I will establish my word with you, which I spoke to David your father, and I will dwell among the children of Israel, and I will not forsake my people Israel. What do you think the Lord's saying that? Why is he interrupting at that particular stage and saying what he does?
They're tempted to follow other gods.
Sorry?
They're tempted to fail, to wander away.
Okay, because he was tempted to wander away. Gail, what? Certainly, it's establishing the position of the blessing. My read on this is the Lord is saying, even this big building you're building me is not the basis of my being with you and blessing you. It's obedience to me that is important, not building a lavish building. So here you are, you're building this magnificent structure. It's a whole lot different than the portable tent that's 500 years old. But it is if you obey that then on that basis, I am going to dwell among you. If you walk in my statutes, obey my rules, keep my commandments, walk in them, I will establish my word with you, which I spoke to David. Okay, chapter 7. And the house has been built. We've had the finish mark on it. And now, again, the writer interrupts. Because what is said in chapter 7, verse 1, should come, if we're doing this logically, and he's doing it logically, but not following reporting logic, but following theological logic. We've just had in verse 38 of chapter 6, the 11th month in the month of Bull, which is the 8th month, the house was finished in all its parts and according to all its specifications. He was 7 years in building it. Solomon was building his own house 13 years. And he finished his entire house. Now, I don't know about you, but that seems like a little bit of juxtaposition. He took 7 years to build God's house, 13 to build his own. Now the 13 follow. But then all of a sudden he describes what he built. he built the House of the Forest of Lebanon. Its length was 150 cubits. The length of the tabernacle was, pardon me, 150 feet. The length of the tabernacle was, the temple was 60 cubits, 75 feet. Its breadth, 50 cubits. Its height, 30 cubits, so it's as tall as the other. And it was built on four rows of cedar pillows with cedar beams on the pillars, and it was covered with cedar above the chambers that were on the 45 pillars, 15 in each row. There were window frames in three rows, window opposite window in three tiers. All the doorway and windows had square frames, and window was opposite window in three tiers. I mean, that's a pretty impressive building. And he made the Hall of Pillars. Its length was 75 feet. Its breadth was 45 feet. There was a porch in front of them with pillars and a canopy in front of them. And later that seems to be a reception room. Then there's another one. He made the Hall of the Throne, where he was to pronounce judgment, even the Hall of Judgment. It was finished with cedar from floor to rafters. His own house, where he was to dwell in the outer court back of the hall, was of like workmanship. Solomon also made a house like this hall for Pharaoh's daughter, whom he'd taken in marriage. And then it describes all the expense and all of the other things. So he spends 7 years building the temple, and then he builds another complex connected to it, which has these five buildings. And they are much larger than the temple. And they're on the same platform in the same area. So if you look at the back of that sheet that I gave you, you can get some idea of what is going on. So do you see this, sort of in the middle, right in the middle of the thing, at the bottom, you see Kidron Valley. Can you see Kidron Valley? Help me here. Can you see where I mean Kidron Valley? So the Kidron Valley runs through there, and just above where it says Kidron Valley, you'll see City of David, and you'll see a small walled area. That was the City of David. Not very large, not very impressive in terms of this picture. Solomon now builds all of this walled area all around. And then if you look at the top, you can see the complex. So this is now what is presently, although the Temple Mount is bigger than this because Solomon increases it. Pardon me, Herod increases it. But Solomon now takes this, and each side, Jewish tradition says, each side of the Temple Mount is 750 feet long. So that's, I'm sorry, my mind is going, 2.5 football fields long. And on that you have, on each side. And on that you have the temple, which is built right where the Dome of the Rock is at the present time. And then you have this other royal complex up there. Now, if you remember, where was the tabernacle? Where was it placed in Israel? In the center of the camp when they were moving through the wilderness. So that was the center. Now, in this time, and David, of course, is the one who inquired this spot, the temple is the center, not of the people's area, but the palace area, the royal complex. And not only has Solomon built the temple there, he's built the house for his pagan Pharaoh's daughter on the same complex and on the same level. And that's in no small matter, I think, troubling. So why does Kings interrupt it to tell us this now, when it would fit later? I think he's making us have some contrast here to, there's something going on. Pharaoh has got bitten with the bug of building, And he began to build the house of the Lord, but all of a sudden now the house of Solomon.
You said Pharaoh.
Pharaoh. Well, Pharaoh's daughter's up there somewhere. Solomon has gotten bitten with the bug of building, and it's begun to have this focus on himself. And the temple has been absorbed into this royal complex, so it now becomes almost the royal chapel rather than the center of the life of the nation. And then I think the author wants us to ask, why does it take twice as long to build? And why is the size of the complex dwarf the temple in its connection? So I think all of these are warning signals that this looks really good, but there's other things that are going on. And before we get to Solomon's life ending by next week, we'll have seen he's built a whole complex of pagan temples up on the Mount of Olives for all his wives to go and worship in, because the accept of chapter 3, verse 3, is getting wider and wider and wider. He loved the Lord. Then when we get to chapter 11, what do we read? He loved his foreign wives. So that acceptance of Solomon's heart is becoming a black hole. Okay, any observations that you want to make here? Gail, we'll wait till Mr. Microphone Man comes around to get you.
The first thing that came to mind is that Solomon was double-minded. I never thought of that.
Yeah, just... Anything else we should notice here? I know this is in some ways, for me it was helpful because I had not worked through to see really how the temple all worked before. And even as we get into the New Testament, it's going to be a even more spectacular version of Solomon's temple when we get to Herod. Okay, well, let's entrust our time to the Lord and move on. Father, we hear you saying, don't you know that you're the temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you, who you have of God? And in some amazing way, we as a church and we as individuals are temples of the living God. Help us to be more faithful with our temples than Solomon, who started so well, came to be with your temple. In Christ's name, amen.